Right, thank you. So in GCU, you have an optimization that's called ICF, standing for identical code folding, that tries to find functions that are duplicates of each other and tries to eliminate all of the copies. And for those public functions that should remain, reject the original symbol to the sole remaining copy. So there are two ways ICF can achieve that. One is creating a symbol alias, which is the example on the left, when we have one function, and then the other function that was originally a duplicate is just a label that points to the exact same code. And the other way is creating function wrapper, when the duplicate function becomes a trivial function that simply jumps to the actual implementation. So naturally, usually we want to have symbol aliases, because they do not create any new code. It is the most efficient way. But in practice, most of the time, GC has to create function wrappers, because the language requires it to do so. The reason is that in C++, you can take a function address, store it in a pointer, then test that pointer for equality against the math pointer, and the compiler has to preserve the observable behavior, so it cannot transform a program in a way that two distinct functions, after optimization, suddenly have the same address. So the compiler has to prove that the address of the function does not matter, and if it proves that the address is not significant, then it may create an alias. Otherwise, it has to create a wrapper. And in general, it needs link time analysis, because for non-static function, you have to have a whole program view of what is referenced and in what way. By the way, in LVM, they have a bit more first-class support for the for tracking address significance. On the binary level, they have a special section that stores for each function whether its address is significant or not. On the assembly level, they have a couple directives for creating and populating that section. And on the bit code level, they have an attribute that can be attached to a function to say that its address is not significant in the C and C++ way sense. And that is not actually just an internal matter of the compiler, but it also matters if you want to help linker-based identical code folding, which also happens, for example, in Gold, there is direct support for that. Also, in GC, you have the issue that the way we create wrappers is somewhat not efficient, because we emit each wrapper after the function that holds the implementation. So we have the pattern where the wrapper function performs a backward jump to the actual implementation. So when the CPU fetches the jump instruction, it's also going to fetch a few instructions just around it. But those fetch instructions will not be used in any way, because we are not going to be executing those. And so that is wasted work each time a wrapper is called. And naturally, we should be able to do better. Another issue is that sometimes GC wants to emit a wrapper, but it cannot. And an example came up recently on the mailing list. The issue is that we support creating interrupt handlers in C by way of using an interrupt attribute that is supported on several targets. And the intent of the attribute is to emit a function that can serve as an interrupt handler on that platform. And usually that implies that it uses a non-standard calling convention, because it is intended to be called by hardware, not by any C caller. For that reason, GC knows how the prologue of the function has to receive the arguments, but it does not support calling those functions from a C program, because usually there is no sense in calling an interrupt handler from the rest of C program. So what happens in this case that if the user program happens to have two interrupt functions that happen to be identical, then ICF comes along and decides, hey, I can deduplicate those, and it cannot deduplicate those by creating aliases because it cannot prove that the address of the interrupt handler is not significant. So it needs to create a wrapper, but in the wrapper it has to call an interrupt function from the interrupt function. And at that point it cannot do that because it cannot correctly emit a call to a function with a non-start calling convention. And so as you mentioned, right now this does not work correctly. It either results in wrong code or in a failure. And naturally we should be able to do better. We should be able to, when we have to create two functions that are virtually identical, that the only difference they have is that they need to have different addresses, we should be able to separate them just with a knob. Certainly we should respect a few things. So for example, we should respect the alignment of those functions. If the user is requesting a specific section name for either of those, we should not try to do that. The target should allow that, and most of the targets should be fine, but for example, on x86, this would need, care should be taken to handle interaction with the control flow enforcement technology. And finally, if there are tools, like for example, in the Linux kernel, that there is a tool, obj tool, that works by scanning binary code, if they do not expect it, then they may be surprised. So, if I am missing something, please let me know if there are any other problems, if it is not worth it in the first place. Because this is not exactly a new problem. The same problem appeared in C++ when there are function tanks that are supposed to do one addition instruction and then call some other virtual functions. And certainly the same problems, the problems with code locality and the problem with eliminating the branch also appear there. So that is what I care about and wanted to tell you about. Thanks.
I guess you should look up the cost, whether in order to avoid emitting too many knobs when it's already faster to do a jump.
Yeah, certainly. So if you have multiple aliases, you'll have like a chain of knobs. And you should not allow the chain to grow too long, but yeah, that.
I have a question about the patches. Do you have patches for it, which can do the magic?
I tried to do that, but the problem is it is not exactly easy to find motivation because I don't know the answers to all of those questions, and like that is part of the reason I'm here. Like just to know what of those problems have been considered and rejected before.
The second question is the alignment of functions. We'll have some minimal alignment of functions, typically 8 bytes. So it's a small issue, I guess.
Yeah, but so on x86, the required alignment is either 1 or 2 bytes. So the alignment we apply right now of 8 bytes is not a requirement. We do it because we feel it an optimization.
In the design of the C++ ABI, I was kind of expected that a function would have multiple entry points for this adjustment, rather than using separate thunks. But that was never implemented because thunks are easier to represent in the compiler. And they are emitted with the Thunke. I think they're currently emitted just after the Thunke, and I suppose we could emit them before. That would be a fairly straightforward change.
Jason?
Yeah?
Plus side, try it.
Okay, guys, unfortunately, we're out of time. I hate to break up a lively discussion, but we'll have to move on to the next one. Thank you very much.